And this, you know, since I was here last year, it was funny. One of the last things that happened in the meeting, I was talking to Pastor, and it was interesting because when I was over at Jordan Victory Center or Victory Church, I had a picture of them doing ministry where there was a long building and there was a wooded area around it. And so I just kept wondering, what in the world is that about? And so when I went and talked to them after the service, I said, listen, are you doing something with like a building where there's a wooded area? He goes, no, we've been working with them. It's been very difficult and we're just seeking the Lord about it. I said, well, I just think you need to go back. And after a year, here we are, and they've got the property. They're moving with the property. They're building. They're establishing. That's incredible. I mean, a period of 1 year. What God has done and what He's continuing to do. I talked to Sheila tonight, and she's telling me how the Lord has gifted her in song, and how that He gave her a song that's being used here in Ireland during the Olympics with the torch, and how the torch is coming to the right today. So the torch is coming today. So it's no accident, prophetically, that we're beginning this meeting on the day that the torch is coming to United Kingdom. Amen. So it's just, I mean, this is powerful. God is doing some amazing things. And He's raising up business people to hear His voice. Now, my wife is here with me. Nan, would you stand up? She said she wasn't coming to any place. In fact, this is interesting. I've traveled all over the world, and we'll be married 25 years. This is my first wife. And my only wife, and the only wife I'll have. And so, you know, after 25 years, every year, she said, I'm just not going anywhere. I'm not going across the seas. But she fell in love with some folks from Ireland, and God just put it in her heart to come. And it's so amazing. Now, my wife is the CEO of our assisted living development, and she oversees a budget of $5 million a year. She made our company this last year. She made over $1 million. So she knows what she's doing. She's a sharp cookie. And so I thank God for her. I love you, babe. My son Michael is with me, which is also a part of this whole thing of a line of wealth. And a line of wealth is not just about money. A line of wealth is about sowing into generation after generation after generation. So my son just graduated from Oral Roberts University just the week before last, and with an international business degree. And has been preaching since he was 16. He wants to go to law school, and he also wants to get an MBA. So we're very much a part of business and ministry and connecting with entrepreneurs. And so I guess I need to ask, how many of you in this room presently right now own a business? Let me see your hands. Wow. Okay. How many in this room don't own one now but want to own one? Let me see your hands. Okay. Nice. Okay. Let's see for just a moment here. Those of you who own business, let me see your hands one more time. Okay, those of you who own business, I want to ask just a few of you right now very quickly. I want you to think about this. Just think about what is one of the major business concepts that you operate in right now? A business principle that's a part of your value system. A business principle is part of your value system. Anybody got one? What's that? Customer car. I love that. Is that what you pick up your customers in? A customer car? Okay. So customer care or service or something like that? Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Customer care. And just give me an idea what that means to you. Absolutely. Yeah, so that's a powerful principle because you don't want to just be able to connect with them one time. You want it over and over and over. You want to be able to, you want them to walk away from you feeling good about themselves and feeling good about the service or product that you're providing. That's a powerful principle. Anybody else? Innovation of new products. And Pastor does a lot of great, great talk about this in terms of just even like Apple and how they've just continued to develop product after product after product. And not only that, but products that you come back to over and over because it's not enough just to sell somebody one thing one time. You want to keep them coming back over and over. So that's a part of customer care, customer and innovation. Anybody else? Looking after your own people. Yeah. Yeah, you know, there's something that's really cool about that, because that's part of this whole multi-generational thing that God is doing, in the sense that we not only have sons and daughters in the natural. Is anybody else hot? Whew, hallelujah. I'm going to take this jacket off and show you that I've been eating really well since I've been here. What was the last one? Take care of your people. Take care of your people. Because that's part of it. And when God blessed Abraham, he blessed Abraham to not only be a blessing to himself and to his family, but to everybody around him. So, yeah, that's good. Anybody else? Honesty and trust. Yeah, it's a powerful truth. And unfortunately, with Christian people and Christian businesses, so often, I don't know, it's probably not like that here, but in the United States of America, lots of businesses that have the word Christian over, Christian business, are sometimes the furthest thing from what would be Christianity and business. I mean, you'd almost want to deal with people in the world because you know what you're dealing with. Understand what I'm saying? Anybody else? Good product guarantee. Yeah, that you're not only that you have innovative products, but you have products that are guaranteed. You know, it used to be when I was a kid, you know, they products came with like a warranty. Now you got to buy a service agreement and a service agreement on the service agreement and service agreement on the, and it almost feels like some products have programmed obsolescence. You know, that's like my cell phone drives me crazy. I'll get a cell phone and it'll work, and you have a 2-year contract, but it only works for about a year. Anybody notice that? Maybe it's just in the U.S. So anyway, there's a lot of business principles that God wants to give us. But before we can operate in strong, powerful business principles, we have to operate in kingdom values. We have to operate in kingdom businesses. So Father, in Jesus' name, right now, Lord, I just ask you to flow across this room. Lord, I ask you to just move across this room mightily right now. I pray for creative ideas. I pray for innovative ideas to begin to flow in this room. I just charge by the Holy Spirit that gifts inside of you that have not come to fruition will begin to activate right now. In the name of Jesus, Father, I just declare that those who have been drained and who are weary and well-doing are going to begin to be filled up with strength and stamina and perseverance tonight. There's a tenacity that's coming to you. There's a refreshing that's coming to you. There's an anointing that's coming to you tonight. Father, there are even some in this room that didn't raise their hand to start business. But Father God, you have it in your heart for them to be business people. So in the name of Jesus, I stir up the capacity to do what you never thought you could do before. In Jesus' name right now. So we just come to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. So tonight I want to go to a really different passage. A really, really out there different passage. I want to go to Genesis chapter 12. Verses 1 through 3. Thank you for preaching my message. And I want to go to Genesis chapter 12. And I want to talk to you on this whole concept of blessing. It's something that you've not heard of before. Genesis 12, verse 1. Now in Haran, the Lord said to Abram, go for yourself for your own advantage, away from your country and from your relatives. Hallelujah. I love holidays, I love Christmas and all that, but you know what? After a few days of relatives being there, I remember why I moved away. So anyway, all right, and your father's house, and to the land that I will show you, verse 2, and I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you with abundant increase of favors, and make your name famous and distinguished. And you will be a blessing, dispensing good to others. Verse 3. And I will bless those who bless you, who confer prosperity and happiness upon you, and curse him who curses or uses insolent language toward you. In you will all the families and the kindred of the earth be blessed, and by you they will bless themselves. He says, Abraham, I'm going to release blessing on you, and not only am I going to release it on you, but then you're going to release it to other people. You're going to release it to the people who you work for, the people who work with you, the people who you sow into, your customers. You are in this business concept, not just simply to provide for your family, but to become a conduit of God's glory, to become a pipeline of his presence. Come on now. Come on now. I'm just telling you, you are in this thing for a bigger purpose than just simply adding to your bank account. And so as I begin to kind of meditate on this whole concept, I believe this is the year 2012. The number 20 has to do, is one less than 21. 21 is three sevens. The number seven is a number of perfection. Three times seven, 21. And 20 is then the number right before 21. It is anticipation of perfection or perfecting. Not perfecting in the sense of being perfect and flawless, but perfection in the sense of coming into a new level of maturity. So 20 represents the number of coming into an anticipation of coming into a maturation process. The number 12 has to do with God's divine order. And in this year, I believe God wants to release some order. I believe that He wants us to become people of priority. He wants us to be more flexible and less rigid. More inclusive and less exclusive. More active and less sedentary. More content and less aggravated. More confident and less insecure. More focused and less distracted. More generous and less self-centered. More thrifty and less extravagant. More compassionate and less judgmental. More humble and less proud. More childlike and less childish. Did you hear that? More spirit-led and less flesh-driven. More courageous and less cautious. You see, if you're going to be in business, you got to be courageous. You got to be a risk taker in order to be in business. More spiritually aware and less, more situationally aware and less oblivious. I found this out as I was up at the, what's the museum we went to the other day? Titanic. I went up to the Titanic and we started reading about Belfast and I started reading all this stuff. How many have been there? Pretty cool. And so we're going through this thing and I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, man, this is an innovative people. Just 100 years ago, this whole region right here had the biggest and the grandest and the greatest linen factories in all the world. Just 100 years ago, you had the biggest shipyards and you were creating the biggest ships in all the world. God has not made you less innovative in that period of time. You are just as innovative. There is a seed and a DNA in this people, in this region right here. I'm just telling you, there is an innovative, creative concept inside of you waiting to be birthed right now. I'm here to tell you that seed, just seed itself, they found a few years ago some seed in Egypt that was 4,000 years old. 4,000-year-old seed. They put it in the ground, and how many know what happened? It started germinating and it started blossoming after 4,000 years. But it was not blossoming for 4,000 years simply because it wasn't placed in the right environment. The Holy Spirit put some business people here tonight to be in the right environment. He put some believers in this room tonight to be in the right environment because there is seed inside of you that is waiting to be germinated. Come on. There's seed inside of you that is waiting to come forth. It's an exciting season. And so he says, I want to make your name great. This word great is very interesting. Hand me that water if you would, baby. This word great has a number of meanings. Just listen carefully. I'm gonna talk fast, so listen fast, okay? I hear you. The word great means larger in quantity and quality than others of the same kind. The word greatness has to do with the extensiveness in time and distance, as in great delay or a great time period. The word greatness has to do with a remarkable or outstanding in magnitude, degree, and extent. The word great has to do with outstanding significance or importance, as in a great work. The word great has to do with a chief or principal or primary or first in line. This is a people here that God is calling to be first in line. Not first in line because you're better than somebody else, but first in line because you're called of God to be exemplary of the things of God. The word great has to do with powerful influence. The word great means to be eminent and distinguished, as in great, as in a great leader. Now this year, I believe in order to step into what He has, you got to let go to hold on. Somebody say, let go to hold on. Say, let go to hold on. God is requiring some folks to let go of some things, to let go of some stuff that's been holding you back. Let go of some relationships, maybe even business relationships that have held you back. He is just declaring right now prophetically, it's time for us to recognize you got to move forward. And Abraham had to move forward. He had to go to some other places in order to hear the voice of the Lord. Because sometimes when you're right, I'm not talking about geographically, I'm talking about mentally, I'm talking about emotionally, I'm talking about in some arenas in your life. And watch this. This is what he said to Abraham. He said, I want you to leave your country. Now, he's not telling us to leave our physical country. What he's saying is, I want you to leave the cultural influences, the ideologies, the idols, the attitudinal atmospheres that are ungodly. I want you to walk out of the ungodly atmospheres, and I want you to bring the atmosphere of heaven to earth. You hear what I'm saying? He says, I want you to leave your kindred. That's your, in the sense of your community, your limitations, your mentalities, your mindsets, what your kindred has said about you in times past, how they have labeled you. I want you to walk away from labels that have kept you in a place that you're, that keeps you incarcerated mentally. Then he says this. He says, I want you to leave not only your country, your kindred, but he says, I want you to leave your father's house. What he's saying is obligations, iniquities, family lines of iniquities. Now, he's not saying I want you to get away from your dad or your mom. Understand what I'm saying? Symbolically, this is Old Testament typology. But in a new sense in the New Testament, I want you to shake off the old and step into the new. I want you to break off cultural limitations and bring kingdom culture into this economy. Come on, strategic people. Come on, strategic thinkers. And so watch what we're going, because I'm really trying to hit this thing fast. But when he speaks about this year, I believe that just like he told Abraham, I want you to leave your comfort zone. He says to Lot's wife, don't look back. He says to the disciples, shake the dust off your sandals. He says to Joseph, name your sons Ephraim and Manasseh. Catch this. When you name your seed, you predict your future. Whew. Somebody say that with me. When I name my seed, I'm predicting my future. You see, what he did is he renamed his past while reclaiming his future. He said, Ephraim, I want to name you. I want to give you. I don't have time to go into it. Whew, man, you know what Ephraim and Manasseh means? Ephraim and Manasseh, the two names. One means I've caused you to forget the pain of your past. And the other means, I've caused you to excel in the land of your adversity. Woo! Come on now. Come on. I've caused you to forget the pain of your past. Now, when Brian came to our place, I was trying to be really, really special and kind to him. And he came to our place, and I brought him a bag of potatoes. And he stood up, and he said, Pastor doesn't understand. He said, he's brought us grit pen. He said, that's when millions and millions and millions of people died in the grit famine. He's brought us grit pen. And he said, we're only laughing because we ought to be crying. You know, and my whole church is sitting there going, I'm trying to be nice and, you know, and do something special and treat him special. And this is what happens. Anyway, I got to leave it alone. I've given it to God. An Irish accent. I need it. Yeah. All right. He says to Ruth, I want you to convert from a Moabite to a Bethlehemite. Let go of the grief of the past in order to lay hold of the gift of the future. He says to Moses, make a decree, not a request. Woo! Come on now. Somebody say, make a decree, not a request. He said, Pharaoh, let my people go. What he was saying is, let my future, let my destiny, let my inheritance go. Somebody felt like you're in a stalemate. You're stuck. You're frozen in time. You've tried to push forward, and it's not happened. He said, Moses, I want you to take my people to a whole nother level. He's declaring to Northern Ireland, I want you to take my people to another level. You are not living in the pain of your past. You're excelling in the land of your adversity. Come on. Come on, it's time to step up to the plate. Make a decree, not a request. Moses walked in. Some folks need to get bold about some positions. You need to get bold with banks. You need to get bold with some contracts. You need to get bold in the spirit. I'm not talking about rude. I'm not talking about arrogant. I'm not talking about flaky. I'm talking about when God speaks to you and you have a rhema word from God, you get bold. You make a decree, not a request. And I'm not just talking about to people. I'm talking about in the spirit realm. You begin to make a decree. This has got to stop. A new season has come upon us. He says to Paul, pen these words. Forgetting those things which lie behind, I press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling which is found in Christ Jesus. So it's a new season. It's a new season. So what has the culture been? What has the culture been? Well, in America, it's kind of been like this. Lifestyle has become more important than life. So I'm willing to go to get in such credit debt for a lifestyle that now I hate my life because it takes so much of my life to pay for the lifestyle that I'm not even enjoying. Anybody with me on that? Wearing the brand has become more important than becoming the real brand. Getting riches has become more important than getting righteous. I didn't say God didn't want you rich. God wants you rich, but he wants you to have nice things, but he doesn't want nice things to have you. Empires of men have become more important than kingdom of God. Services provided have become more important than services given. That's what you're talking about over here. TV has become more important than JC. Hollywood has become more important than holy ways. Outward has become more important than inward. Tangibles have become more important than intangibles. Finite has become more important than infinite. Pleasures have become more important than real treasures. The vessel has become more important than the contents. Confirmation has become more important than transformation. Aspirations have become more important than God's affirmations. Come on now. The messenger has become more important than the message. Saving the animals more important than saving the babies. I'll just leave that one alone. The temporal more important than the eternal. We work so that we can rest rather than resting so we can work. We give so that we can get rather than getting so we can give. We live so we can eat rather than eating so we can live. God forgive me. We empower the provocative, the sensuous, while emasculating the virtuous. We feed the physical while starving the spiritual. We elevate the wrong while putting down the right. We promote the flesh and demote the spirit. We emphasize the non-essentials and de-emphasize the essentials. We sugarcoat the poison and strip the soil of its nutrients and minerals. What should be alarming has now become alluring. What should be repelling has now become appealing. What should be detestable has now become suggestible. What should be wrong has become right. What should be illegitimate has now become legitimate. What should be good has become bad, and bad has become good. The facade and fantasy have become more important than veracity and reality. Athletics have become more important than apologetics. Apologetics, defense of the gospel. Are you catching what I'm saying here tonight? So here's the culture that Abraham was called to walk out of. Very much like the culture that we're in today. And so the first thing God says to him, these are the ands that follow the commands. Somebody say the ands that follow the commands. There's a sevenfold blessing that we just read with Rocky, and I want to just break that down for you tonight. Number one, and. Now the word and is not in the Hebrew, but it is implied. And each one of these blessings, these sevenfold blessings, start with the word and. Now, he says these ands following if you will walk away from the ideologies of your culture, if you'll walk away from the iniquities of your father's house, if you'll step out of these, the ands will follow. I could give you 1,000 business principles. My wife and I also own, well, along with some other guys, 13 restaurants, or not 13 restaurants, but 5 restaurants that made $13 million in income this last year. They were investing back into new restaurants. I could tell you a lot of business concepts. Even as a preacher, I could tell you a whole lot of things about business. But the reality is, until we get our spirit right, I don't care how much money you've made, you may not have made it for the right purpose, and the enemy will use it to destroy you at times. So watch this, and I will make of you a great nation. We already found out what the word great means. You'll become a launching pad, a foundation, and a platform for greatness. You'll become a great people with a great product and great customer service and great company and great marketing and great strategies and great training and great distribution. And the funny thing about it is the enemy is going to be shocked. Look at your neighbor and say, the devil. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, the devil is going to be shocked when he sees what God does with you. It was a shock when God used a prostitute named Rahab. It was a shock when God used a murderer named Moses. It was a shock when he used an adulterer named David. It was a shock when he used a deceiver named Jacob. It was a shock when he used a terrorist named Paul. Listen to me carefully. I'm not just running through a bunch of stuff to say it. I'm talking about us now. We all have issues in our life. I'm talking about the enemy is in for a great shock. God has saved Northern Ireland for a great purpose. God has saved this region for a powerful moment in time. It is going to shock the enemy out of his head. He thought that the violence in this country had brought you to a place of your knees and falling down. But actually what it did is it brought you to your knees to rise up. Come on. You are not a people without a purpose. It will shock the enemy. It shocked him when a betrayer named Paul, when God used a betrayer named Peter, a terrorist named Paul, a doubter named Thomas, a pouter named Jonah, a weeper named Jeremiah, a foreigner named Ruth, a liar named Abraham. He used some barren women named Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Hannah. When he used a man of unclean lips named Isaiah, he used a slave and an ex-convict named Joseph, a teenage girl named Mary, a drunkard named Noah, an exiled man named John. Man, when God uses exiled people, that's when the enemy is really shocked. Are you understanding what I'm saying? He used John to write the last book of the New Testament, thinking nobody will ever hear this one. I don't care what revelations. Leave him alone. He's on an exiled island. Nobody will ever hear this. And this book right here is one of the most powerful books. The book of Revelation is unbelievably powerful. And it's not a book about the Antichrist. It's about the Christ. Come on. So watch this. It was a shock. Come on, get ready for this. It was a shock when he used a fatherless man named Timothy. It was a shock when he used a lion and a bear to prove a future king. It was a shock when he used a donkey to talk to a disobedient prophet. It was a shock when he used a whale to save a drowning prophet. It was a shock when he used a colt to carry a conqueror. It was a shock when he used a swarm of bees to kill a giant. It was a shock when he used a fish to pay Jesus' taxes. I'll take some of that. It was a shock when he used a lamb to save the world. Hallelujah. It was a shock when he used a pack of dogs to devour an evil queen. It was a shock when he used a raven, a scavenger, to feed a prophet. It was a shock when he used a scapegoat to carry the sins of his people. It was a shock when he used a dove as a symbol of peace for mankind and an affirmation of his son. It was a shock when he used his son named Jesus, who spat in a man's eye, who walked on water, who walked through a wall, who read people's minds. This is the original X-Men, by the way. He fed multitudes with a little boy's meal. He healed incurable diseases. He ascended through the air. He calmed the winds and waves. He turned the water into wine. He raised the dead. He cast out demons. He made blinds to see, deaf to hear, mute to talk, lame to walk. He appeared and disappeared. He predicted the future. He exposed the hypocrisy. I'm talking about Jesus. It was a shock when he raised him from the dead. Wow. It was a shock when he used a young man with a sling and a stone. It was a shock when he used a young maid and a tent peg to kill an evil king. It was a shock when he used a skinny little long-haired man and the jawbone of a donkey to kill 1,000 Philistines. Whoo, come on now. It was a shock when he used a man named Elijah to call down fire from heaven and outrun a chariot. It was a shock when he used a man named Gideon and some trumpets and some broken lamps and 300 men to intimidate, annihilate, and totally rout armies of thousands. It was a shock when he used a man named Shamgar and a stick to prod cattle to kill 600 enemy soldiers. It was a shock when he used an ark in the water and a colorful ark in the sky to remind mankind of his judgment and his mercy. It was a shock when he used a man named Joshua with faith to command the sun to stand still so he could have enough daylight to win a battle. It was a shock when he used a man who stuttered to represent him before the highest level of human authority in all the known world. It was a shock when he used ancient bones of a dead prophet to raise a dead man. Woo, can you imagine that? Somebody threw a dead prophet on they threw a man down on a dead man's bones, and when he fell on the dead man's bones, all of a sudden the corpse came back up. Whoa! Can you imagine what a shock that was? We serve a shocking God. I said we serve a shocking God. It was a shock when he used a widow with just two mites to sacrifice the largest gift in all of Israel. It's a shocking God that we serve. And he's raising up a people who are going to shock the enemy out of his mind. The enemy counted some of you out. The enemy put you in a category that couldn't be used. But I'm here to tell you today that God has called you to make your name so great that you could cause a nation to rise up. The second thing he says is he said, and. Somebody say, and. See, these are the ands that follow the commands. And I will bless you with abundant increase of favor. Wow. Favor. My children have got my favor. My kids have got my favor. I mean, from generation to generation. My daughter called me. I was telling Andy about this before the service. My daughter called me and she said, Daddy. She said, I want to go to the beach. She's going to school in Orlando, Florida. Pray for her. It's just a terrible thing. Bless her heart. Has to be down there in all that sunshine. Y'all don't know what that is here, but it's this red, this big yellow thing up in the sky. It's amazing. So if you ever get to see it, you know, just like take a picture of it or something. It's astounding. Really feels good. But I haven't seen it in a while, but it's really great. And so she's down there in Orlando, and she calls me. She says, Daddy, can I go to the beach? And I'm like, sweetheart, who's going? She says, like, Mark and Bill and Dan and Dave and Jerry. And I'm like, I said, and what about the girls? She said, well, all the girls are going shopping. I'm like, oh, baby, don't you feel the anointing to shop today? I'm like, no girls are going to the beach. She said, no, but Daddy, I don't have any money. I said, no, I'll send you some money, baby. And you go with the girls. And so I hang up the phone, and I'm like, what just happened? She not only got my permission to spend my money, but she got it from me. Now, that's what I call favor. That is stinking crazy. I'm like, who's the one with a college degree here? He says, and I'll bless you with abundant increase of favor. I will cause you to have favor, to be empowered to succeed, to prosper exceedingly, to have contentment and joy, to speak his good intentions, all those things that Rocky talks about, to add value. I love this about God. I was a zero, and I stand up next to God, and I get multiplied 10 times. For every one of you who were multiple zeros in this room, every time you stand up to God, I mean, you might have been six zeros and you stand next to God, you become multi, multi, multi. It's unbelievable. You become millions in his presence. The next thing that he says, and I will make your name famous and distinguished. I like that. I'll make your name famous and distinguished. I'll name you because your name has to do with all that you are, have, and do. Abraham, when I speak over your name, you're just Abraham, but one day I'm going to breathe on your name. And when I breathe on your name, I'm going to breathe upon it, and you're not going to be Abraham. You're going to be Abraham because I'm going to breathe on your name. And my breath on your name is going to give you such inspiration. And so I begin to think about this, and I begin to realize that when God breathes on your name and makes it distinguished, he makes your name synonymous sometimes with a good or a product. I don't know what your product is. I don't know what your good is. But he makes your name synonymous with that thing. And if it's going to be a name that people are blessed by, you want it to be a name that it corresponds with kingdom values. But watch this. He says, I'm going to make your family name will trump every other name. Anybody ever heard of a guy by the name of Trump around here? He says, your name will out Kardashian every other name. Only young people in this room might get that. Your name will create a dynasty that will out-ming the Kennedys and the Bushes. Your name will become synonymous with a good product or service more renowned than Sony, Ford, John Deere, Timken, Cadbury, Harlandin and Wolf, Mercedes, I didn't say it right, but you know what I'm talking about. Your name will out Einstein Thomas Jefferson and philosophically out Plato Socrates. When your name is distinguished, your name will make history, shape the present, and shake the future. Your name will be remembered for winning more battles than Alexander the Great. Your name will outcook, and I don't know who are the great cooks in Ireland that are on TV. Anybody? Yeah? I didn't know what you said, but yeah, that right there. Your name will outcook in America, Mrs. Fields, Bob Evans, Betty Crocker, Chef Boyardee, Julia Childs. Your name will outlast Timex, Rolex, and Seiko. Your name will let the good times roll faster than Kawasaki, Yamaha, and Harley Davidson. Your name will sell more records than Elvis, the Beatles, Michael Jackson. That would be unbelievable, wouldn't it? Your name will soar higher than the Wright brothers. Your name will outpaint Picasso, Da Vinci, Monet, Van Gogh, and Michelangelo. Watch what happens when your name becomes great. It gets associated with something, and now that name carries something bigger. See, when I think of Sony, I don't think of a man named Sony. When I think of Ford, I don't think of Henry Ford. I think of the car. Because now his name has become associated with something now that is rolling throughout the world. Business people, God wants to make your name great in whatever area of life that your talent, skills, and abilities are in. That's what he wants to do. Check this. Number four, and. Somebody say and. And you will be a blessing, dispensing good to others. In other words, you'll become an instrument, a tool, a weapon, a pipeline, a vehicle, a conduit, a healing agent, a catalyst for change, a measuring stick, a standard, a warehouse, an armory, a dispensary, a supplier, a pharmacy. What's going to happen? You will become a place of blessing. People will run to you for what's in you. There's something great in you. There's some knowledge in you. There's wisdom in you. You've been through some battles. You got some battles under your belt. You've been to some places they've never been. You've got some understanding they don't have. So people are going to come to you. Come on, business people. Come on, people of God. The fifth thing he says, somebody say, and. And I will bless those who bless you and confer prosperity and happiness upon you. What he's saying is, I will make it in vogue, not politically correct, but kingdom correct, to say good things about you. Oh. He says, I will bless those who bless you. Now, there's some folks who may never bless you, but the ones who get it will get it. Think about that. I said, the ones who get it will get it. Number six, he says, and curse him who curses you and uses insolent language toward you. Somebody say, and. So, and he will take it. We don't get excited about the fact that God's going to curse somebody for our sake. We get excited about the fact that we don't have to open our mouth. We don't have to defend ourselves. We don't have to stand up and step up and try to explain all the stuff to people. Our father and our daddy already knows about us. How much time have I got? 5 minutes over? No. All right. And then he says, the seventh one is this. And you will, and in you, all the families and kindred of the earth will be blessed. And by you, they will bless themselves. Catch this. You're going to be blessed, and by you, they will bless themselves. How many know some folks that have never had permission to bless themselves? They go through life dissing themselves. They go through life putting themselves down because everybody in their whole world has put them down their whole life. And so he says, by virtue of you being in the room, people will come in to buy your product. People will come in a spirit of depression and oppression, and they will walk out declaring blessing over themselves, having been in your presence because you've been in the presence of God. You literally give them permission to bless themselves. Wow. As they say in South Africa, show. Do y'all say that? Yeah, all right, that is a South African thing, right? Sure. Okay. Ish. I was going to say that next. Yeah, ish. Ish. So what happens is you give them permission to bless themselves. Listen to this as I close here in the next. How long did you take to close?
no
You are not just made by the Maker. You were made of the Maker. Say this, I was not just made by the Maker. Come on, say, I was not just made by the Maker. I was made of the Maker. Now listen to what this means. You were made out of the God kind of material. When a cow makes milk, the milk is not just made by the cow, it's made of the cow. Fruit is not just made by the soil, it is made of the soil. You do not have or nor ever will have His omnipotence, His omnipresence, His omniscience, but you are created in His likeness and image with His nature and His character. You speak His words in season, it's as if He's speaking. You were not made in Ireland, China, Japan, Mexico, India, or even in the U.S. You were made in heaven in the heart of God's imagination for such a time as this. You were made in heaven for such a time as this. What does that mean? You are the master physician's prescription for a sin-sick generation. You are the master chemist's antidote for the toxins in a poisoned people. You are the master creator's most ingenious invention for a generation that has wasted and used up its natural resources. Listen. You are the master strategist's surprise weapon released just in the nick of time on the battlefield of a lost generation. You are the master writer's most descriptive, diplomatic, and well-placed word, releasing hope to a love-starved generation. You are the master chef's most closely guarded secret ingredient to spice up a bland, flavorless, and tasteless generation. What is that? I preached on it last time I was here. Salt. Yeah, you are His most guarded secret ingredient to spice up a bland world. You are the master craftsman, most beautifully and intricately and skillfully crafted masterpiece displayed to bring inspiration to a hopeless generation. You are the master's locksmith, carefully made up master key to unlock the doorway to potential possibilities and purpose for a stuck, stranded generation. That's who you are. Seven principles of generation, the ends of blessing, the ends that follow the commands. That's who you are. That's who you are. That's what you are. Now, Father, in the name of Jesus, right now, I stir up prophetic gifts. Because prophetic gifts are what people use when they're in the stock market when they don't realize they're using it. It takes prophetic insights to know where to invest and where not to invest. It takes prophetic insights to see greatness from generation to generation. Michael, Dana, come up here with me for just a moment, son. Whew. Wow. From generation to generation. Now, when I release the blessing to him, it's a next two generation blessing. It's not just one portion blessing. It's a double portion blessing. But if you could see what happened, my great-grandfather got a blessing. He was he didn't have any land. He didn't have anything. And he made an application. And President Teddy Roosevelt signed a decree that my great-grandfather would receive land. When God wants to bless a man and a woman, He gives them sons and daughters, and He gives them land. And watch this. He blessed my great-great-grandfather who had nothing. He passed that on to my grandfather. My grandfather was dying with 11 major diseases, and I would not be here today if God hadn't raised him up. He raised him up, and he began to speak into my dad's life. And my dad began to receive that blessing. With every generation, there's been a double portion anointing that's flowed. Now, in this room, there are some folks that don't understand that. You say, well, you know, I'm the first in my generation. No, you're not. The first came with the second man, Adam, Jesus. And the anointing that he wants to release you is a greater anointing. It's a double portion anointing that he is releasing to you. Son, stand up for just a moment. I'm releasing to him not just an anointing, but a double portion anointing. He's not just going to operate in ministry. He's going to operate in business. He's going to operate and speak in the realm of politics as a prophet in his generation. He's already doing it. He was a Fox News contributor for Michelle Bachmann back during the elections. God has already used him in a supernatural way. Son, I want you to just release a prophetic prayer over this crowd before we close tonight.
Okay. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would bring an entrepreneurial spirit to this house, innovation and witty ideas. Father God, that you would bring a creativity to your people. Father God, that only people who know the Creator will have and in their possession. Father God, for kingdom resources, because you're the God that owns a cattle on a thousand hill. And Father God, if even the very pavement of heaven is clothed in gold, Father God, how much more can you give to your children? Father, I thank you that John says, if earthly fathers give good things to their children, how much more will your heavenly Father who is in heaven give to those who seek him earnestly? Father God, I thank you because you said all these things will be added unto them who seek first the kingdom of heaven. Father God, I thank you that our priorities are coming into the kingdom of your resources. Father God, as we seek you, Father God, in the time of intimacy, that you would empower us with the knowledge of what is to come. Father, out of the intimate place, that you would give us a knowledge for business. Father God, even on an international level, Father, that we wouldn't be closed-minded, Father God, that we wouldn't just do the work of the mechanic, Father God, that we wouldn't just be the worker, Father God, that we wouldn't just be the managers, but Father God, that you would show us that it's how the business operates, it's the process, it's the environment, it's how we develop our employees, Father, it's the whole entire thing that is the business, Father, that you would give us insight, that you would give us insight and vision and purpose, not only for ourselves, but a multi-generational investment, Father God, that will continue and be a standard, Father God, that will be raised up. In Jesus' name, I thank you.
Amen. Hallelujah. Wow. Are you charged up? Just a little bit? We serve a mighty God. Amen? Thank you, Pastor Dana. That was awesome. Bless you, man. Bless you. Please, I want you to, when we go home, I know the Irish don't go to sleep on the same day they wake up. Is that right? Sure. But I want you to go home and I want you to get ready for tomorrow. Because tomorrow the guys are going to be releasing to you some stuff. I've heard some of the stuff that God's going to be sharing. It is unbelievable. Okay? I want to confirm for you why you need to meet with God. Why it needs to become consistent. I want to confirm for you that God set aside just for you a place to download to you the miraculous of heaven. I'm going to show you in Scripture. Brian, Lewis, Mark, Dana, incredible things to share tomorrow. Come ready. Come with a mind to receive what God's got. Amen, guys? Let God speak His rhema word to you so that the gates of hell will not prevail against what He's told you. That you will go be these people that have come from nothing to what God's called you to be. Isn't that wonderful? Amen. Can I bless you? Seeing as we've spoken about blessing tonight. Well, stand up then. Come on. Go on, see you guys now. Why don't you just grab somebody's hand next? Let's just make a unit here. Lewis, there's an acceleration coming to you, my brother. It's almost like God's prepared you in some kind of fitness thing as a picture of you're really going to need to be in tune because He's going to move so quickly by the Spirit that you're going to have to follow quickly and accurately. Because He's going to do something through you, my brother, and through your ministry, which has not yet been done in this nation. You're going to have to run with the horses. It's a new acceleration coming to you and to your family and to your ministry. And may God bless you and keep you. May God grant to you all that you need to keep abreast of what He's saying in the name of Jesus. And so I say to you all tonight, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you His peace. And even as I have spoken to you, the blessing in the name of the Lord, the word says, so God has blessed you. You are empowered to succeed. You are a benefit. God has added value to you and made your name great. He has accelerated your purpose. He has blessed you with health. He has blessed you with wealth. He has blessed you with love and with joy and with peace. And may you go in the strength of His might and be the people of God in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, folks. Thank you for coming.